All of the thorns surrounding you start to hiss and slither about. Your heart starts beating out of your chest as the thorns start to move closer and closer. An explosion so loud commences that all you can hear is the ringing in your ears. As the ringing stops, hi friend, I'm going to transport you into a dark fantasy story. Come and join me by the campfire, and I will tell you the spiritual dark fantasy story titled Thorns of Callousness. This is the Beery Tale. Thorns of Callousness. Hey kid! A deep and crusty voice shouts in your ear. A stinging sensation envelops you as that same voice echoes inside your head. You feel a hard bump on your right arm. Your arm aches. Everything's dark. Have you been sleeping? Did you faint? Or has something worse happened to you? A gray light gradually manifests in front of you. It's blurry, but at least it's better than pitch blackness. As you blink, you slowly start to see two silhouettes before you. One tall and feminine, while the other is male and very short, probably below a meter. The male silhouette stands closest to you and is most likely the reason why your ears are ringing right now. After blinking a few more times, you finally see the baby blue chainmail armor and the long blonde hair of your friend, the paladin, Gina Odrus. She's clasping her hands together as she gives you a look, reminding you of a mother concerned for her child. Just after that, a male face, no higher nor larger than a small child's, abruptly leans into your line of sight, completely blocking your view of Gina. The man snaps his fingers as yellow fire bursts out of his fingers. He moves the fire back and forth in front of your eyes. He snaps his fingers again, and the fire is gone. Considering his height and his ability to conjure fire out of thin air, this man must be a halfling wizard. He wears a green and brown outfit and a pair of green glasses that almost completely covers his face. They look just like two upside down ale pints. The man's brown hair sticks out in all directions and, well, evidently his hair isn't friends with either comb or brush. The curious man grins and stutteringly chuckles a bit. I'm sorry about your ear, kid. He scratches the back of his neck, glancing over to Gina. Yeah, you don't need to remind me for it. Gina's done that a couple of times already. Gina lets out a deep sigh, releases the grip of her hands, and then walks up right next to you and the curious man. Well, standing about 2 centimeters from someone's ear and then shouting for crown and country may be considered overkill, but what's important is that our friend is okay, right, Frogrin? She playfully blinks and gives the two of you a wide smile, her white teeth glistening in the sunlight. True macaronis as always, Gina. Frogring heartedly chuckles as he taps Gina on her left knee, which is about the maximum height he can reach. Friend, she locks her gaze with yours. And Frogring, bending her head a bit in order to look Frogring in the eyes. She then faces what has been looming behind Gina and Frogring all this time. It's a vast forest, consisting of purple thorns stretching as far as the eyes can see.
Somewhere inside there lies the purple diamond that is rumored to contain extensive healing properties. With it, we can finally purify the drinking water of my home village, Frogring finishes.
Gina nods.
Exactly, I I can't imagine what you're going through right now, Frogrin. I really feel for you.
Gina bends down and gently rests one of her hands on Frogrin's shoulder. Yeah, hopefully we'll be in time to save Grandma, who... Frogrin abruptly stops. His voice starts to tremble. He shakes a few seconds, then straightens his back, collected once again. My grandma, she drank from the water while it was poisoned. She doesn't have much time. A cold wind blows by, gently caressing the three of you. Nina closes her eyes for a moment, and then faces the forest again.
We need to be quick once inside the forest.
Why is that? Frogrin asks.
Because anyone who enters this forest of purple thorns will be consumed by it and turned into purple thorns themselves, effectively becoming a part of the forest itself within an hour.
That really sucks cucumbers, Frogrin mutters while clenching his teeth. Do we have a map?
No,
Gina simply states, while determinedly gazing towards the purple thorns, her blonde hair swaying in the wind.
I've searched everywhere and asked everyone I could think of. This place is so ancient and so dangerous that no one has ever been able to make a readable map of the area. And the thorns move on their own daily, so even if someone actually managed to, it'd still be pointless the next day.
So, in and out within an hour then? Gotcha. The purple thorns are everywhere. They completely cover the sky. They are placed in all directions and wherever you look, effectively blocking out all sunlight. It feels just like night here, even though it's still a bright and sunny day outside. Gina walks in the front, then you, and lastly, right behind you, Frogrin. He shudders slightly, and it's not because of coldness, but of fear. Man, this place really gives me major creeps, he says as he shakingly adjusts his green ale pint glasses with one hand and scratches his ruffled hair with the other. You catch Frogrin's green wristwatch, which lets you know that you have 30 minutes left to find the purple diamond.
Just stay close, Gina whispers. We don't want to attract the attention of the thorns.
What now? Frogrin exclaims.
Shh.
Gina pauses for a second, standing completely still and gesturing to the two of you to do the same. Frogrin completely freezes, looking just like a scared cat, raising rag and all. A chill runs down your spine while the two of you wait. Gina listens. At first, it's quiet. Then you're starting to hear faint whispers.
This world is not enough. You are not enough. I don't get enough. I am not enough. This world doesn't give me enough.
The whispers grow fainter and fainter until all is at rest again. Gina waits for a few seconds before she finally sighs.
Okay, we're fine for now. Yes, Frogrin, these thorns are alive and, well, they kind of want us to become a part of this forest and join with them in their ungratefulness and callousness.
Frogrin's eyes grow wide behind his screened and overly sized ale pint glasses, and he does his best to whisper as much as he can.
Gina, why didn't you tell us this before? Well, I didn't want to give you guys another reason to turn back. I deemed what I said earlier to be enough, and, well, we'll be fine as long as we stay quiet.
Frogrin places his hand on his forehead, looking down on the ground.
Okay, just slip in and out of a forest full of touchy thorns that love to drag us all to hell in order to search for a freaking diamond we don't have a map to within an hour. Just peachy,
Everything's just peachy.
Just as Frogger utters that last whispering word, Gina looks back to him in order to whisper something back to him. But when she does, she unconsciously steps on one of the thorns, which gives out a loud crunch. The three of you completely freeze as all of the thorns surrounding you start to hiss and slither about, moving just like a recently disturbed pack of snakes. Your heart starts beating out of your chest and you feel cold sweat starting to form all over your body as the thorns start to move closer and closer. Well, not closer towards you and Frogreen, but towards Gina. Gina's eyes widen, her pupils constricting to peppercorns as all of the thorns in the whole forest move in towards her. Gina stands frozen, just like a statue, hoping that will be enough for the thorns to leave her alone. All of the thorns move in as close as a few centimeters from Gina's body, and she visibly starts shaking, her baby blue chainmail armor clanging with each shake. Then, all of the thorns back away in unison, just as the fencer bracing itself to prepare for the killing blow to its opponent. Frogreen looks just as if he's been hit by a cannonball in the stomach, having completely lost all his air. Gina throws a loving gaze to both you and Frogreen and slightly smiles one last time before she completely closes her eyes, forcefully presses them together, clenching her teeth. This clenching then transitions into clenching her whole body. A single tear runs down Gina's cheek and...
Time stop!
Frogger screams at the top of his lungs, his tears spraying all over the place.
I won't let it end like this!
The scene in front of you shows Gina awaiting her final moments and the purple thorns moving in for the killing blow. But instead of continuing, everything is still. Just as if the scene has turned into a motionless photo. Frogreen stands with his back slightly bent forward. He huffs and wheezes as sweat drips from his halfling forehead. Frogreen's breath slowly goes back to its normal pace and he stands upright again.
I can't take this. Let's get out of here.
Frogreen looks at you and as if catching your concern, he quickly replies.
We'll come back, no worries. I just need to gather my thoughts.
The time stop spell will last for a while yet. As he finishes that sentence, he throws a small metallic item out of his pocket, and this item gradually grows and transforms into a metallic flying machine, reminiscent of a flying saucer, right up until its metallic upper parts folds down, revealing a bed behind a glass cover.
Don't look at me like that. I need this for my beauty sleep and relaxation, nothing else, alright? Come on, let's go.
Frogreen claps his hands together as the two of you start to levitate from the ground, up right next to the flying saucer. Frogreen grabs what looks like a remote from his other pocket and presses one of its buttons. Something buzzes inside the flying saucer as the glass cover opens up to the right, just like the lid of a garbage can would open. Frogreen claps his hands twice, and the two of you gently land on top of Frogreen's saucer bed. The bed is so soft, unlike anything you ever sat on before. It feels just like floating in calm water. Frogreen presses his remote again, and the glass cover closes, protecting the two of you from any dangers outside.
Fly!
Frogreen then utters. And the flying saucer does just that. It flies right through the purple thorns covering the sky without breaking them, just as if they were transparent. Outside of the forest of purple thorns, you are first greeted by the sky and the gentle sun, but the flying saucer doesn't stop there. It flies higher, higher, and higher. The sky gradually darkens, and finally, the blinking lights of the stars greet you, and when you look below, you can see the world. Yeah, this is where I go to relax, and where I go to calm myself when things get too rough, like it did today. Frogreen sits beside you
his legs outstretched in front of him. He gazes up towards the stars and sighs. You know, I really love Gina. She's my best friend. I just can't lose her. I'll never allow that. Never, ever, ever. The stars seem to blink even more as Froggring continues. You take this short moment of respite to relax yourself as well. She's the only one I can go to with bad news. Well, I guess I could go to others with bad news as well, but you wanna know the big difference between them and her? She actually listens. She doesn't like slam me in the face and tell me how stupid I was for letting something happen, or laugh at me or blame me, or worse, just ignores what I say and then instead tells me of something bad that happened to them years ago. Gina just listens. The shooting star quickly flies by. It is gone as soon as it appeared, but still beautiful nevertheless. And when I succeed at something, or when I create something I am proud of, she doesn't remain silent, ignore it, scoff at me, act uninterested, or tell me, "Who do you think you are?" like others might do. She actually helps me celebrate. She helps me celebrate my victories, no matter how big or small. She celebrated with me after the defeat of Nerol the Dark Knight, the ruler of the Otherworld and self-proclaimed god. As much as she celebrated when I managed to create my first potion. To be honest, that potion wasn't even that good, but she celebrated with me regardless. It didn't matter that it wasn't perfect. It was enough that I managed to do it. That's a true friend. Someone who listens to your bad news, and someone who helps celebrate your achievements. Never let go of someone like that, okay? Froggring wipes something off his face with one of his hands and sniffles. Oh man. Allowing yourself to cry now and then is really healthy. For a man too, you know. Especially considering the stigma that many men carry. You can't cry. You need to be strong and brave. And bullshit like that. I say, if you need to cry, and you allow yourself to do that, despite what everyone else thinks, that's a prime example of being brave, if you ask me. Among the stars, there appears to be another flying saucer floating about. But now, it's gone. Oh, and while we're still here, and as a thank you for listening to my story, I'd like to teach you something. This is something that will help you in real life, as long as you choose to allow it. Twin shooting stars suddenly run by the two of you and Froggreen's flying saucer. You know, when stuff has happened to me that I really liked, stuff that I'd like to happen again, I've started saying a phrase, and this phrase has made that wish come true. This phrase is really simple. Each time something happens to you that you liked more of, then just say, out loud or in your mind, "Thank you, universe. Please give me more of that." And that's it. The probability that it'll come true will be very high. I can promise you that. I'm a living example, because it's happened to me. Being grateful is a superpower many people don't use, but you now know of one powerful way to use it. Froggring coughs, recomposes himself, and then stands up. Wanna know what I'd like to do now? The stars of the universe appear to be burning even brighter now. Because you listen to me, just like Gina usually does, you granted me the power to finish this. That wouldn't have been possible without you. So thanks to you, I'm gonna burn some ungrateful thorns. As he finishes that sentence, he presses a button on his remote once again, and the flying saucer immediately starts falling down towards the world and back into the forest of purple thorns. The glass cover opens, Froggring snaps his fingers, and the two of you are suddenly back on the ground again, with the flying saucer nowhere to be seen. Gina and the purple thorns still remain just the way you left them. We have about 10 seconds before the time stop spell fades, so it's all or nothing now. Just between you and me though, I actually have an ace up my sleeve. All thanks to you. Frogging winks at you through his green ale pint glasses as he throws both his arms into the air and starts muttering something in a different language.
Stand back, kid!
As soon as you step back, both you and Gina are completely covered by an egg-formed rainbow shield, as Frogrin is quickly enveloped by fire so red it almost hurts your eyes. The fire circles around Frogrin faster and faster, just like a fire dragon.
This one's for you, Gina!
The crimson-red dragon fire is of such a bright light that you need to cover your eyes, as Frogrin determinedly screams with all his might.
Flare!
An explosion so loud commences that all you can hear is the ringing in your ears. But thanks to Frogrin's rainbow shield, nothing happens to you. You're completely safe. As the ringing stops, so does the red crimson light, which allows you to finally see what's going on. The rainbow shield is gone, as is the whole forest of thorns. Every last bit of purple thorn, completely disintegrated by Frogrin's most powerful spell. A spell so powerful, it may even rival that of Gandalf's or Merlin's powers. And there, among all of the ashes, floats the purple diamond, with not even a scratch on its surface. The sun shines brightly and gently upon you as the light blue sky greets you. A shockwave hits you, making you lose your balance slightly. The time stop spell has ended, and Gina falls down on her knees, crying. Frogrin runs up to her like a child about to buy his first ice cream, while he gestures to you to follow right along. The both of you stand in front of Gina as she looks around her surroundings, wide-eyed and with her jaw dropped.
What happened? I thought I died. Am I dead?
Frogin runs up to her, embracing her. No, we saved you, silly. While on her knees, Frogin actually reaches up quite a bit, almost in a way any other human would be able to hug her. Here, you choose whether you join in embracing Gina or not. Whatever you choose, she embraces back so intently, pressing her eyes shut. She sobs as more tears runs down her cheeks. As her crying ebbs out, she first catches the view of the floating purple diamond. She deeply sighs with relief, looks at Frogrin and says,
"Your grandma and your village is going to be okay now."
Frogrin nods so hard, his ale pint glasses almost falls off his face, but thankfully, he managed to catch them before they do. Frogrin grins off an ear-to-ear smile, his ruffled hair looking even more ruffled than before, if that's even possible. Gina then finally looks at you, not in a regular way. She looks right into your soul, because she knows what you've done today. Finally being freed from the clutches of the thorns of callousness, she gives you one of the warmest smiles you've ever received in your life, as soft sunlight lights up her smile even further.
Thank you so much. I am so very grateful for you.
If you'd like more stories like this one, then be sure to become a member on my Patreon page. You can click the link up here, or check out the link in the description, where you can get even longer Patreon-exclusive stories. I upload every Tuesday and Friday, so be sure to subscribe so you don't miss any of my stories or other content. In the meantime, you can always watch this story. And it's really good, and exciting, and yeah, pretty dark.